evening from Copenhagen, Denmark, and good afternoon to our guest who is in Palm Springs, California. This is Age of Truth TV. Please like our video, subscribe to our channel, and hit the bell for notifications. You can find all of our videos and our library on our website, Age of Truth TV, which is our home. You can also find us on BitChute and Brighton and other places. But now it's time for an explosive, a fascinating episode of our show with a guest who's been with us several times. It's always a pleasure to have him on. He has so much information to share, and he has just published a new book called Confessions of an Illuminati, Volume 8, From the Rise of the Antichrist to the Sound of the Devil and the Great Reset. Once again, with his charm, his wit, and his fiery Italian spirit, we welcome on the show Leo Sagami. What a man.
Thank you very much for this great introduction. I couldn't have done it better. Of course, it's a big book, almost 700 pages, and it's already been a success in the first few weeks we have released it. And we are glad to say that this is the first book we actually have published in two languages simultaneously, which means Italian and English. And it was, as you can imagine, really an immense amount of work to get a book with over 1,000 citation footnotes, and of course a book dedicated to a subject which is usually, let me tell you, Lucas, not really, I think, studied in the serious way it should have been approached from the start. Because here we are not just talking about Hollywood Illuminati or Satanism in Hollywood in a superficial manner. No, this book goes into the detail of the history of Hollywood right from the start, 1909, 1910, the very first film of D.W. Griffith, the age, of course, of the silence films, all the way into the rest, of course, of cinematography, which then becomes, from an initial conservative force, which, of course, saw also the Red Scare, McCarthyism, and of course, going after communists, to a complete the opposite. After 100 years, we are instead to the woke mafia, who is pushing their own sick agenda in places like the Grammy Awards, which of course I discussed in detail also in this book. And recently we have seen once again another confirmation of their hideous work and ideology, because this book is to explain this book for me in a nutshell is like basically trying to show everybody, especially the young people, because I hope that also young people will be interested in reading and studying this book, how to protect themselves from this level of manipulation. And of course, it's not only cinematography, but it's also music. And as you know, I have also been directly involved in music for many years as a record producer and a DJ. And so my own experience goes in this book, as well as also my own family experience with my grandmother, Felicity Mason, Anne Cumming, who, of course, worked directly with people like William Burroughs and Brian Gysin for many years. So there is a lot to cover in this show today for Age of Truth. And thank you for having me on.
This is just so wonderful. And for people who want to hear more about your backstory and your fascinating history, being a rather high-ranking Freemason and being part of these secret societies linked to the Illuminati, which is why you've wrote so extensively about it, they can see our first show that we did quite a number of years ago, which was a huge success on the channel, an Illuminati whistleblower with Leo Sagami. And they can hear that to understand and go through all of your history, because that was very popular. But we don't want to talk that much about your background, because we already covered that. But in this book, I mean, a lot of people would say, wow, another fat big book from Leo Sagami, 700 pages. This is volume 8. Can he keep on writing? What more is there to say? You've talked about Satanism, the agenda of the New World Order. and all of these things linked to it. And of course, all of the Vatican secrets, and we certainly also want to get into that, but there is more. And this time, I think it's very fascinating for people because this is about Hollywood. This is about movie stars and movie actors and singers and music, and also the sound of music, the frequency of music, which you will go into, and you talk about this the sound of the devil. All of it seems to be linked to the devil and Satanism. Why, Leo?
Well, thank you for the also explaining. My past books have been about really trying to going to the depth of this Illuminati network made of various secret society, not only the society called Order of the Illuminati, because already back in the days when the Order of the Illuminati was founded, there were also other Illuminati, like the order close to Louis Claude de Saint-Martin used to call themselves Illuminati. So we can say that Illuminati really are something that belongs to the tradition of the ancient mystery schools. But some way along the line, they got corrupted. They got into the dark side. And this book explains how an heresy, which I've already talked about in Volume 7 and also in Volume 4 of my Confessions, the Sabbatean Frankist heresy within Judaism, it's connected to Hollywood, because Hollywood becomes their playground right from the start, and also the playground of Aleister Crowley's followers. In fact, Aleister Crowley's first Gnostic Mass wasn't done in London, wasn't done in Paris. It was actually done in Hollywood, in a little side road of Hollywood Boulevard, by some of his acolytes. And Crowley, as soon as he saw what was going on during his time in the United States, a controversial period of his life, which has been written extensively about, he saw that these people could actually be the ideal subjects for his own work, you know? Especially because he noticed that they were, he said himself, they are overindulging in cocaine, orgies, and all the rest. Well, it seems like the ideal setting for Aleister Crowley, no? For his followers. And in fact, between the 20s and the 1930s, we see the birth of a lodge in right there, where we have basically on a side road of Hollywood Boulevard. And then later on, this lodge is going to move out of there in Pasadena. But the history of the OTO is basically the history of the modern Illuminati, who embraced fully this telema, this do what thou wilt philosophy, which wasn't really a creation of Aleister Crowley. We need to go back to Rabelais. There is, of course, a long history when it comes down to do what thou wilt. But let's talk about Hollywood. Hollywood is born out of an idea that basically started to come together between 1909 and 1910. Now, in that specific period of time, Aleister Crowley was conducting a ritual in Northern Africa, a ritual to evoke Coronzon, the demon of the abyss. And in that period of time, a Freemason called D.W. Griffith arrived in a small community here in Southern California on a dirt road, which would become Hollywood Boulevard. He decided to shoot his first film in all California. Then later on, in 1915, he also filmed another film, which became very controversial, The Birth of a Nation. It became controversial because he portrayed the KKK as the heroes of the movie, going after the black Americans. It's, of course, we go from one opposite to the other with Hollywood, it seems. But with this movie sanctioned also the birth of the collaboration. And there is, of course, documentation, FOIA documentation that was released to confirm all this, basically with the military industrial complex. They gave them the tanks that basically were used, very primitive tanks. We're talking about 1915, so you can imagine a little more than big cans of Coke on wheels. But it was that sanctioned this collaboration that then lasted until now. And from the 1930s and 40s, they actually opened an office, which is still in existence, the Pentagon in Hollywood. And in my book, I show the inside of the office, the people who are responsible for this office. And I talk about also his history. So this book talks about the esoteric side, but it also talks about the military industrial complex side of things, because it's all part of the same project. And you can't really separate one from the other. So for the first time, I explain how the Hollywood Babylon myth, Hollywood Babylon, of course, we go back also to that famous book, volume one and two, of two books by Kenneth Anger. Now, I used to know Kenneth Anger very well. I actually show also in my book letters he wrote me and all that. Kenneth Anger, for people who don't know, is alive and kicking. He's a member of the OTO, but he's the guy who inspires sympathy for the devil of the Rolling Stones. He's the guy who was considered the magician of the 1960s by the big bands back then. So, and also he made these underground movies who were actually occult rituals. He made a movie called Invocation of My Demon Brother, which actually was the first version of Lucifer Rising, but it was stolen by Bobby Bezalel, who ended up with the Manson family. So the story is incredible. I mean, there is some great anecdotes also, like, for example, Bobby Bezalel stealing the Lucifer Rising movie, which was basically a ritual conducted by Anton LaVey, Kenneth Anger on stage, the music of Mick Jagger, and all these people, and Bobby Bezalel, who later on will be arrested, because Bobby Bezalel will be arrested for one of the assassinations conducted by Charles Manson's family. And of course, what happened was that Bobby Bezalel stole this movie, he brought it to Death Valley, he dig a hole, he put it in, and it was never found again. So some frames of this movie survived, not enough to make a long, reel out of it. So Kenneth Anger decided to just publish what was left as Invocation of My Demon Brother. And then he started to film this movie again, this time with the help of Jimmy Page from Led Zeppelin. And he ended up basically staying many years in Jimmy Page's basement until Jimmy Page got fed up and kicked him out. The movie basically took 10 years for him to edit and put together. It only lasts something like 45 minutes. I mean, it doesn't even last an hour. And this movie, it's another occult ritual that brings us also closer to the concept that they were trying to project here. Because with Invocation of My Demon Brother, the movie ends up with Bobby Bezalel carrying this kid and saying, this is the product of a ritual. Basically, they were talking about the Antichrist that is also portrayed by Roman Polanski, who was himself somebody who used to go to these black masses of Anton LaVey right from the foundation. Because there is also this connection with Anton LaVey. You see, I talk in this book about the developments of modern Satanism, how it developed. We can say that the original milieu where it kind of sprang out from was the Theosophical Society of Madame Blavatsky. And of course, Aleister Crowley became a protagonist of that milieu, and with the OTO, when he got initiated, well, actually, he got recognized immediately at a high level by Theodore Royce, who was the co-founder of it with an Austrian gentleman. And this OTO got kind of hijacked by Aleister Crowley, who himself wanted to promote, though, after 1904, the revelation that he had in Egypt, because we talked just earlier about the rituals he conducted between 1909. Then in 1910, he went back to London and he conducted another important ritual. The first time that Crowley did a public ritual on a stage, it was like a rock event, because it was like seeing Marilyn Manson on stage cutting himself like this, totally out of it on peyote or God knows what kind of other drugs, doing this ritual. And so I wanted to explain that Hollywood is the product of all this. And so
was Aleister Crowley part of the foundation of Hollywood? Was he there that early? And also, I think a lot of people will be interested in knowing if what you're saying is right, obviously, that Hollywood was based on a satanic idea, actually, or that occult philosophy.
Sure. Okay. So what happened was this. Freemasonry laid its foundation in Hollywood because D.W. Griffith was a Freemason, and later on all the various people, Warner Brothers. I explain even in this book all the lodges where they used to meet and everything. So this book has details that are very much correct. Like when it comes down to what Crowley thought about Hollywood, of course, I went on to the work of Kenneth Anger, because Kenneth Anger is a reliable source when it comes to that. But also because Kenneth Anger is the guy who picks up on the Hollywood Babylon concept, which now has been also just released with a new movie with Brad Pitt, Babylon, which is kind of like taking much of what I wrote here, but in a fictional way. Why there is this connection with Babylon and with the occult, like you just asked me. In 1916, a year after the birth of a nation, there was a lot of criticism about this movie from D.W. Griffith, because he was, of course, characterizing the KKK as heroes. So he went immediately on the defense, putting out another movie. This other movie will be the link to Hollywood, between Hollywood and Babylon. I'm talking about Intolerance. Intolerance is an incredible movie that uses 10,000 actors, and part of the movie is staged in ancient Babylon. And they used 10,000 actors, and they had to reconstruct. They didn't have graphics like today. They had to actually reconstruct the whole set, the gates of Babylon, Ishtar's elephants. Everything was there. And it was left there for years in that dirt road that was Hollywood right at the start. So that gives you the idea of why then it became Hollywood. But it was like an occult foundation. The Babylonian story, which is portrayed in Intolerance, and everybody can go on Google and find Intolerance as well as Birth of a Nation. So, of course, Intolerance was his way of trying to get people to take him seriously again after the Birth of a Nation was heavily criticized for portraying and glorifying the KKK, the Ku Klux Klan. But he was a Mason, and him, together with Charlie Chaplin, founded then United Artists. These are the founders of really the and Charlie Chaplin was a pedophile, as well as many say a Freemason.
Do we know that he was a pedophile?
Yes, we know he was not only a pedophile, he was also a communist. That's why in the early 50s, when he left Hollywood, he never went back. But there was also investigations on him regarding having taken advantage of a 14-year-old boy and many others, maybe.
Really? Well, we do know that he had a lot of children, and he kept on having children when he was in his 80s, I believe. But that, well, nobody would suspect that he was a pedophile. But I mean, you've done some research on that, yes, or what?
Well, absolutely. I mean, all the research that I've done has been conducted in archives, police archives, FBI archives, archives of foreign intelligence sources.
There seem to be such a huge network of pedophiles in Hollywood working around the Hollywood, and not just actors, but also people behind the scenes. I mean, that is of course linked to Satanism, but like my first question, what was it? Was Hollywood even founded on the philosophy of the occult and Satanism?
It was founded by Freemasons, so they laid the foundations of Hollywood.
But not all Freemasons are Satanists, and a lot of them don't know about what is actually going on when they reach the higher levels.
The Freemasons in Hollywood knew exactly what they were doing when they were laying these foundations, and that's why also this reference to ancient Babylon from a Freemason who was D.W. Griffith. It's true, low-level Freemasons, they don't know much, but at the same time, they partake to something which is, of course, manipulated from behind the scenes. And when it comes down to Aleister Crowley, he wasn't only Freemason, he was also a member of this organization called the Ordo Templi Orientis. So we shouldn't, of course, how you say, make confusions between these organizations, because, of course, people might say, then you create, you know, you want to just mix everything up and create a chaos out of it. No, I discuss very much in detail what the lodges involved with Hollywood, the Freemason lodges did, but also what the OTO lodges did and what other organizations did. But the Occult Foundation was definitely laid there at the very start from Freemasons who had knowledge about occultism. That's the truth. Why you have Babylon and basically the gates of Babylon, this amazing scenography left for years in this dirt road that used to be in the middle of nowhere and starts gathering people from all over the world. And basically it becomes like this new attraction, which is cinema and cinema. I mean, when I wrote this book, I didn't see Babylon, the recent film which has been published by the maker, the film director of La La Land. But recently, people who have seen it, and I've not yet wanted to see this movie because I want to wait.
No, I haven't seen it yet either.
But what happened is that some friends of mine, their daughters went to see it, and they were shocked. They were shocked because it contains Satanism, blatant Satanism, in-your-face Satanism. The decadence of it confirmed everything I said in my book. So it's like they tried to, of course, with Babylon, keep the fictional kind of element. Like they didn't want to reference to direct names, so then people would go and research and say, and then they will, you know, when they start researching, they will make 1 + 1 = 2, and they will understand the whole thing. Keeping it in the realm of fantasy, with Babylon, and it kind of gives them the possibility of talking about truths that can be very uncomforting for some people, just like it happened with the TV series dedicated to Jack Parsons, Rocket Man, with basically the CBS canceled the whole series after, I think it was 2 years, this series with Jack Parsons, which literally showed us very much we're not talking here about Elton John, Rocketman. I want to confound people. Here we are talking about Jack Parsons, who was basically the guy who, in fact, in reality, it should be called Strange Angel, because Strange Angels, Jack Parsons is the original Rocket Man. And he's the guy who was working for what became later on NASA, right at the start. So it's basically Strange Angel, the title that you should search for if you want to find this TV series, and rather than Rocket Man. But the subject of this drama series is very detailed. I mean, you can see the occult rituals when they used to come here in Palm Springs, when they used to be doing the occult rituals of the OTO. It's very detailed. The fact that Jack Parsons was connected to this lodge, which was born in Hollywood between the 20s and 30s, developed, and then he became part of it later on, and between the 30s and 40s, he even had the possibility at one point to welcome into his lodge Hubbard, who became later on the founder of Scientology. So we have Strange Angel, for example, is just another, you know, like fictional, but not fictional, because actually, when it comes down to Strange Angel, the TV series, they have been much more detailed and accurate. They wanted to portray more a biographical kind of situation rather than leave it to fantasy.
Yeah, but and Hollywood is known throughout the ages to put out truths and a lot of wild stuff that actually is the truth, but they put it under the guise of fiction. And we've seen that so many times, also in the X-Files and even Star Wars, and also all the the Kubrick films and Polanski films, and you just mentioned Polanski before also. He was linked to the whole Manson murders and Sharon Tate and Rosemary's Baby and Mia Farrow and all of these. And this is also
when it comes, for example, to Mia Farrow, I have also a very detailed account of the 60s and what she did when she went with the Beatles, when she visited the Beatles in India, what happened back then with Mia Farrow. The sister of Mia Farrow, both have said to have actually inspired a couple of songs by the Beatles who were there during that period. And Mia Farrow later on said she was actually raped by the Maharishi. So, I mean...
Really? And she was also married to Frank Sinatra during the time of when she did Rosemary's Baby.
In fact, she went... after I think she divorced from she broke up from Frank Sinatra, and to, let's say, recover, she went to India to visit the Maharishi, where everybody was hanging out, having this mystical time. Now, I explained why all these people were attracted to these Indian gurus that were arriving from the Far East back then, because they were basically accepting what was promoted for a long time by the Theosophical Society, the embracing these gurus from the Far East was actually first done by the Theosophical Society.
Madame Blavatsky was
later
into...
on Annie Besant with, of course, Krishnamurti. So here we are in a situation, this book, that doesn't speculate on anything. This book doesn't have one speculation. It has the most credible sources. And I wanted to also give the possibility at the end of the book, people can go, and there is over 1,020 footnotes and citations from credible sources that they can verify every single thing written in this book, because I didn't want to just say something and then have somebody coming, but that's not true. Oh, okay, it's not true.
It's always important to substantiate whatever you're writing.
Yes, I think that the big problem with some researchers in the truth movement has not been to cite enough and make people acquainted with the original sources of where you are taking all this knowledge from.
There's a lot of confusion in this truth movement, and sadly, it's very divided, and that's not a very good thing. We talk about it a lot here also, but we like to invite all kinds of speakers on, but I think it's up to the audience to actually make their own judgment whether or not this resonates with them or not.
One thing, Lucas, I was talking not so long ago with a Freemason about something. I can't even remember exactly what. There was an information that I gave out on one of my articles, and he was critical about it until I actually gave him the source, and the source was verified. And so at that point, he was like, he backed off. He said, okay, you're right. But he said, can't I be critical? I said, no. When you have information that is proven to you 100%, you can't criticize facts. You can criticize me maybe making an hypothesis or maybe theorizing or maybe being critical of something because I personally don't like it. You can criticize that.
People can criticize your opinion that you're writing in your book or saying, but whatever you have researched to be right and a real quote or a fact, that should be...
Yeah. Because my work is, first of all, as an investigative journalist. Of course, I was directly involved with the secret society, so it gives me an advantage point here, so I can always analyze things with a different perspective. And that is an advantage. But I want to still do the work of an investigative journalist when I conduct this kind of work, because also another thing, Lucas, if I didn't write all those, if I didn't put on my sources, I would be sued. And I would be ruined by these people.
You would. And also a lot of people would not believe you or read your books. But I mean, it's extensive research that you've done, and you really go very in-depth in all of those books. And that's why I guess a volume 8 is now out. I mean, this is quite extraordinary, huh? Quite a library.
Yeah, but for example, volume 7, you know, is about the occult roots of the Great Reset, Klaus Schwab, and all those people. It's very rare that those kind of people can drive you into a lawsuit because it's not their interest to give you any credibility. When it comes instead to the show business, this was the first time I had to be even more detailed than ever to avoid any problem. Aside from the fact that I live in Palm Springs, I know a lot of people in Hollywood. My friend Roseanne Barr has been a victim of the Hollywood establishment. She's just coming out now with a new show after so long on Fox Nation, which is actually dedicated to the fact she was canceled.
Coming out with a new show? That's amazing to hear, because really she's been through a lot, Roseanne. She's quite remarkable, isn't she?
Absolutely, and she's launching this show on Fox Nation with a big ad on the Super Bowl night, so it's going to be a big thing, and I've spoke a lot with Roseanne about it, and she was very helpful when I did this book, also when it comes down to some of the information. So, you see, I try to do this book without any speculation. And I talk, for example, also of our common friend, the late Jordan Maxwell.
I was just going to mention Jordan, our mutual friend there. Of course, there's so much knowledge that not only we heard from him, but you got firsthand, huh?
No, but also involvement. He was involved in Hollywood during the whole period of his life as the heir to Manly Peol, who was, as some of you may know, a very celebrated Freemason and, of course, very knowledgeable about the esoteric world. And his heir has been for decades until his death last year, Jordan, who, of course, was doing these events in the middle of the night in Hollywood studios where all these film directors will come and they will gain information from him. So, and then that information will then be relayed on films like Star Wars, George Lucas, or we're not talking about small things here. We're talking about things that have characterized the history of Hollywood. So his involvement also with various hip hop personalities, music personalities. And so I wanted to really also give him a tribute in this book. In fact, there is a photo of his tribute that was conducted inside a Masonic lodge when after his death. And for the first time, I actually show a photo inside here of the tribute inside the Masonic lodge. So there is...